permission to join us in standing as we begin the service. And I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth were passed away, and there was no more sea. And I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down from God out of heaven, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a great voice out of heaven saying, "Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and he will dwell with them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be with them and be their God. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes, and there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away." And he that sat upon the throne said, "Make all things new." And he said unto me, "Write, for these words are true and faithful." We're gathered this morning, ladies and gentlemen, to celebrate the life of a valiant soldier of the cross who held record membership here in the Seventh-day Adventist Church in Long Bay, Brother Ewart Stewart. And I invite you now to turn with me to your programs as we make use of the hymn titled, opening hymn, "How Cheering is the Christian's Hope While Toiling Here Below."
Fly, lane, ring. that blissful home. We long to see thee as thou art and reach that blissful home.
Let us reverently bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, once again we are faced with the present reality of death. Death challenges life. But thanks be to God, Jesus conquered death. And so today we come with the blessed hope in view, thanking you for the life of your son, Ewart Stewart. He lived and he lived and he left a legacy today in his children and grandchildren and the life he lived. We pray that as we come today to give you thanks for his life, that you will just be with this service, be with the family members, be with all who mourn today. We pray that this service will be done to bring honor and glory to your name and to give hope and comfort to the bereaved. Thank you, Lord, for hearing and answering, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. The program will flow as you have it, and so I am going to ask that you pay keen attention to the program, all our participants. I also want to ask that we put our cell phones on a mode that will not have them disrupt the program, whether it is that we're going to put them on silent or vibrate, or we're going to turn them off. So, and then there's only one turn and it's your left, and the bathrooms are right in front of you. I also want to ask all those who are participating in the program that as you come to the lectern, any of these microphones can be used. They are all set for that purpose. And so you do not have to come to the lectern, neither do you have to remove the microphones from the stand. Unless it is imperative that you do so, we ask that you use them as they are provided in the mic stands, as they are set within the context of the protocol that we are supposed to observe. And so at this point, we're going to be having a scripture reading, and that will come as is printed. It's coming from Psalm 27, to be done by Janelle, Brianna, and all the other grandchildren, Elder Lena Stewart, and Karen Stewart Anderson, Courtney Stewart, and just as it is in your program, we ask that you'll just know who is in front of you, come after that individual, and then free flow we solicit from you. So we'll now have the scripture reading by the grandchildren.
Good morning, everyone. Okay. We want to thank you so much for sharing in this day with us. We really appreciate it. As Pastor pointed out, we are going to be reading Psalm 27, and I want to say that this was my granddad's very favorite scripture. All right? It reads as thus, Psalm 27. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When the wicked, even mine enemies and my foes, come upon me to eat up my flesh, they stumbled and fell. Though an host should encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war should rise against me, in this I will be confident.
One thing have I desired of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For in the time of trouble he shall hide me in his pavilion, in the secret of his tabernacle shall he hide me. He shall set me upon a rock.
And now shall mine head be lifted up above mine enemies round about me. Therefore I will offer in his tabernacle sacrifices of joy. I will sing praises unto the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry with my voice, have mercy also upon me and answer me. When those cities seek you my face, my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I seek. Hide not thy face far from me, put not thy face away from me.
Everyone, my name is Elena Stewart. I'm the wife of Ewart. I had just left school, and two smaller siblings and myself were still living with our father. Our father would go to school in the morning and return in the evening. So we three girls would take turns in fetching water for him to wash himself when he came home in the evening. It was the grape season, and we all went to get grapes with our friends. When we came back, my father was already home, and the water was not there, so he was upset. He took the grapes from us and he said he was going to throw it away and he was going to beat us. So this young man, we were all seeing for the first time, came up to him and said, "All right, give them a chance," which my dad obeyed, and it was surprising because when our dad was going to beat us, the whole neighborhood would knew. Because he would call to them and said, "What part of the room do you want?" So we as children were very scared of getting a flogging. While this young man was there, my father was building a new house, and he was on another occasion while we were working at the house, some ladies came here to kneel a young, and there were three other boys standing there working at the house, and they bought kneel a young. They asked me to do the lunch, and then when I took the lunch, if I took the lunch, then they would be home. They went home back. When I saw that they were there, he offered to follow me home. When I was near the house and saw the light, I said, "I'm going to be here, so I can't meet you." And so I tried not to make a loud sound because he was far away. My brother, who was a fisherman, was down by the seaside, and he saw these people selling boats. He invited them home, and they started Bible classes every Friday evening. My husband had a lot of time. He wasn't so interested, so he would leave whenever time they come. But then he started to get interested, showing interest, and he started to ask questions. So we were doing the Bible study together, and he said to me, if we're going to join the church, we'd have to get married. And so we planned to get married. But I remember my mother had to sign, because I was still young, sign for me to get married. So we got married on the 26th of July, 1970. And on the 2nd of August, we were baptized in the Mansion Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church. He was a deacon there, and so I moved my membership to Long Bay because of the children. After a while, he also removed it. And I watched him there and could do nothing. And I know that he will be missed by a lot of people. Even people who had tried to help in the community did not think that at that moment he needs such help, and they did not. But I'm here just to say, if he did live a faithful life of such, which I know, I'm trying to live so that I can meet him on that day. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for coming to honor my dad. It will be difficult to give a tribute to my dad in 2 minutes, but I'll try my best. Adjectives have lost their descriptive accuracy to rightly describe how much my dad meant to me. He was selfless, kind, compassionate, and a giant of a man. I was blessed to have him as my dad. He was one in a million, a rare one. Every step I've taken in life was with the guidance he has given me. His wisdom and guidance has made me into the strong woman I am today. He was my rock, a great listener, my confidant, best friend, and would not stop until he got a response from me. I miss those daily calls, his presence, and his voice on the telephone. He would cry out, "Minasio," as we made a video call, and I would quickly send him the video request, only to see that big grin on his face. All he wanted to know was that I was okay. Sabbath evenings were the best, because while Mom would be busy doing the church books, he would call, and we would talk for ages. I could tell him anything. He knew when I was hurting, and he would always encourage me to trust the Lord, that things would work out. He was always there for me whenever things went wrong. He always gave me advice to help me to be strong. I relied on his wisdom, and he withheld nothing from me. Dad always referred to me as his princess, and I wholeheartedly believe I was his favorite, until I found out he called all my siblings a princess or a prince. He loved us all unconditionally and equally. Even my daughter would also remind me that she was also his princess. We were also special to him, and he only wanted the best for us. Our world turned upside down the day he departed this earth. But we know he's resting in peace, awaiting that great resurrection morning. My life will never be the same without him. I would do anything just to hear his voice one more time. As a child, we referred to him as Swellington, because he was always so serious and was very strict with us. We only understood that he wanted the best for us and that he loved us dearly only when we became adults. It was our delight when Mom was away at conventions, because it meant he would be cooking. We would be called to the dining table, and the dinners were all the same sizes. There were no differences in ages, and we were never able to finish our food because there was just too much. We had great fun playing cricket as a family, as that was his favorite game. I was always the one setting up with him in the wee hours of the morning, watching cricket as well as boxing. During the boxing, I would always have to duck, as he would be boxing as if he were the one fighting. Dad believed in a sound education and endeavored to ensure that we all completed high school and went into further education. I remember at primary school, we had the privilege of attending all the school trips. Dad would wake up early and walk us to the school when it was pitch dark, and when the trip was over, he would be there waiting. He was a great father, second to none. We would begin the day with worship at 5 a.m. in the morning, and we hated it as children. However, as adults, we'd learn to appreciate the value of worship, even with our own children. Dad set the examples, and we gladly followed. As children, and even as we became adults, we would open our eyes during the prayer, as his prayers went on forever. He had to list the names of every child, as well as every grandchild. He was a disciplinarian, but that did not beat us often, but the ones we got lasted a lifetime. A look was enough to set us straight, and this carried on even into adulthood. Till this day, I still know what that look means. Dad would always say he wants the best for us, and that he would rather sit on a stool so that we could sit on a chair. He often say it's not how much we earn, but how much we save. That has never left me. I remember when I came back from England as a young adult. I'd worked all summer and came back feeling I could spend my money as I wished. He called me aside and encouraged me to buy a goat as an investment. Reluctantly, I gave him 500 Jamaican dollars. He bought the goat, and that one goat yielded several goats. My dad was able to buy several pieces of furniture from that one that goat money. My dad taught me the value of saving, and for this, I am grateful. There are so many memories of my dad that I will cherish forever. My dad would be the first to call as I embarked from the airport each time I visited. One of my sisters would pick me up, and he would ring every 15 minutes or so
to see how far we were getting in getting home. At times we were a bit tired of him calling, but how we'd love to hear that call even one more time. When I got to Portland, you'd be sitting on the veranda waiting up to see us. As the car approaches the hill, you would just see that big smile. He was so happy to see us. My visit this time was so different. He's sorely missed. Before I go, let me hasten to share my last conversation with my dad. For those of you who knows my dad, you will know he loves to talk on the phone. And so I had the privilege of speaking to him every day. I spoke to him just as I was about to go up to bed. Surprisingly, he was lying down. I asked why he was lying down, and he said he wasn't feeling well in himself. I asked if he was in pain, and he responded by saying no. He continued to say, "Don't worry, I'm okay." I reassured him that Mom would take him to the doctor the following day, and I told him good night. I went off to bed only to wake up to his death. I say to you today, whatever you can do it now, because we don't know when. Though I'm no longer a child, and he's no longer here, I'll never let go of the memories. I will always hold them dear. As we grieve his loss, let us celebrate the enormous legacy this humble, kind, and loving dad has left behind. We're extremely proud to call him dad, husband, granddad, brother, uncle, and friend. We love and missed him dearly, but we are grateful for the man he was and grateful to God for giving us one unique specimen of a man to be our dad. Thank you.
Good day to everyone present here today. I'm Courtney Stewart, the second born of Miss Cherry and Moss Money. I regret that I have to come across to you this way, but unfortunate circumstances, I can't be present at my dad's funeral. Moss Money was a very special and unique individual. I was really inspired and touched by the things that he taught me, that kept me throughout my life and guided me. I just want to say I'll miss him so much, but I'm glad that I'm strengthened by the things he taught me that will carry me through my life. May the good Lord bless and keep him. Let not your heart be troubled. In my Father's house are many mansions. Live in love.
Ewart Alfonso Stewart, my dad. He would say, a dad is someone who would put his hand in filth so that his child, his precious daughter, would never have to do it. That was one of his favorite expressions and something that he demonstrated. Although he did not have formal education, he ensured that all of his children received sound education that would help them to function in society. I remember when I was going to university, many of my friends, many who had more financial resources than I had, were looking for student loans. My dad sacrificed. He dug deep to ensure that my fees were paid in full each year. Dad instilled godly values. These were principles that he himself lived by. Morning devotions were a regular staple in our house. We learned to trust God, have a relationship with him, and pray about everything. I'm so going to miss this man. His counsels, encouragement, just me constantly being in his thoughts and in his prayers. What a treasure I had. But I look forward to be reunited with my dad on that great resurrection day.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ethel. On behalf of my sister, Mrs. Laurel Grace, and I, we are extremely heartbroken at this time for not being able to personally attend our dear brother's funeral there in Jamaica. We are unable to travel due to my sister's failing health and the fact that I am vulnerable to COVID virus. Our sincere condolences to our sister-in-law, Miss Cherry, and her family. That is something only God understands. In memory of my brother, Manny, he was my brother not by choice, but by the nature of our birth. As children growing up, Manny and Charles and myself were the youngest of seven children. We were very close. We were well behaved and we spent a lot of time together. And we were involved in a lot of games playing, namely marbles, baseball, and cricket, which was Manny's favorite game. So he made a cricket area where we could play regularly when school was on holiday. Apart from that, we have jobs to do at home where we would look after the goats and the chicken each morning before attending school. Manny was keen on going to the seaside, so he made a bamboo raft, which he took to the sea. The other boys in our district tried to make friends with us so that they could go to sea also. Manny allowed two of them to go to sea with us. I hated sea, so I just sat at the shore and watched them in the water. Manny learned to swim quickly by taking the raft to sea. My brother was a just and noble man. He would give away his right for the sake of peace. May his soul rest in peace. And I will always remember my brother for the time we spent when I visit Jamaica. We would sit on his veranda for hours talking about past times. His favorite game now is domino and wrestling. When I showed him the wrestling on my phone, he would laugh and laugh and laugh and could not contain himself. May his soul rest in peace. From his sisters, Laurel and Ethel.
There's no disappointment in heaven, no weariness, sorrow or pain, no hearts that are bleeding and broken, no song with a minor refrain.
Everyone, my name is Warren Anderson. I am the oldest grandchild. Unfortunately, I'm unable to attend the funeral. However, Grandad has always held a special place in my heart. Being the oldest grandchild, I remember those early trips to Portland, you know, before the house was even the house is today. Always there for church. Grandad was always the first to leave, first to up in the morning. Always telling me to make sure I go to church, read my Bible. Always rings me every couple of weeks. We'll definitely miss those calls. But it's with great sadness, obviously. He's passed away unexpectedly. But just have to be there for Grandma going forward now. And the love will always be there. Thank you, and hopefully visit Jamaica early next year.
Being one of the most presentable people in the room at all times. Anyone can see from a mile away that he didn't only care about his image, but the image of his grandchildren. The only time my granddad wasn't smiling was when he was sleeping. None of me or my siblings were ever brave enough to sneak past him when he was sleeping on the veranda during the day. He was one of the only men I knew that could have such a good personal image without worrying about what people thought about him. He lived a wonderful life with God as a close companion at all times. The only opinion he cared about was God's and no one else's. I see a part of my granddad whenever I look at any of my family, whether that's my aunties or my dad. He will always live on in the features and characteristics of my family.
Dear Grandad, it's been over a month and I still can't believe you're gone. I keep expecting me to walk up the lane swinging a machete or something. Or for you to come and find me to ask whether your outfit passed the mark or if it's so on. Your passing has really highlighted to me how you don't know what you have until you no longer have it. I'm sorry I missed so many of your calls and I didn't call back as often as I should have. I will miss our calls and talks and your advice. You always made sure that I stayed focused in school and was doing the best I could. You also made sure that I was staying connected with God and was making efforts to stay in relationship with Him, as that is the most important thing I could do. I have so many memories of our time together, but one of my favorites was when we would have special treats in the evening. I would sneak you a bag juice if I was having one, or bring you extra ice cream when no one was looking. We would always laugh about those moments because we would always get caught. I always remember when you went to get your first pedicure, and you were so excited from the night before, right up until you came skipping up the lane after your appointment. You were so excited to show off your new toes to the whole family. I still think about that moment and laugh. I will always cherish these moments we have together. I always dreamed that you and Grandma would be coming to my wedding when the time came, of course. I was even prepared to move my whole wedding to Jamaica in case you were both unable to fly. I will always miss you and cherish these moments. All I can do is take comfort in the hope that we will meet again. Love, Princess.
I believe I speak for everybody when I say my granddad was a role model. This man was a walking example of where faith, love and loyalty can get you in this world. The relationship he had with the Most High, his wife, his children and his grandchildren is something I aspire to have in my own life. On a personal level, my granddad was my anchor to humanity. His love and care for me reminded me that even though there is so much wicked around you, there are still people like him who will go the extra mile to make you feel special, no matter how many miles away. He made sure I was always chasing my dreams, and he'd always call me and tell me how much him and my grandma both love and miss me. Hearing that from the two people you miss the most in this world, was unmatched, and that's something I'll treasure for the rest of my life. I always remember mocking you for how you used to call my grandma's name when you were hungry. I remember how shiny your eyes used to look every time you were smiling too hard. I remember how you kept us up to date with our education from when we were younger all the way up to our adulthood. And most of all, I always remember your seat on the veranda. How you were able to comfortably lay your head and sleep, I'll never know. So on behalf of your grandchildren who couldn't be here, or the people like your grandchildren that couldn't get the chance to write a tribute for you today, we love you and miss you so much.
My grandfather was a very kind man. I remember the first time I learned that people called him Manny. I was young and he was sitting on the veranda and I joined him and said, "Good afternoon, Manny." And he looked at me and smiled and said something like, "Me is not money to your little boy, me is your grandfather." In fact, I remember one of our last conversations on the phone. I was at university and him and grandma called me just to check on me. And they both reminded me how proud of they were of how far I've come in my education and how far I've come in my life and how I should be a role model to all my younger siblings. How I should carry on in the light that I'm shining. I'm gonna miss them so much. I just have to be strong and everyone has to be strong. I just want him to know that if I had the chance, I would tell him that I love him so much and I miss that smile of his. He would bright up any room that he'd walk in. And standing here today, I'm happy to see everyone who's here for him. We love you and we miss you, Granddad, and you'll never be forgotten. There's no one like him.
Amen. At this time, we're going to be lifting an offering. That's where we are in your program. The offering in aid of the community services and outreach ministers of the Seventh-day Adventist Church here at Long Bay. And we ask then that you give, as you are impressed to do so, toward this cause. Those receiving the offering, please take your places. Not yet. I just want to get those lifting first.
Stewart was a symbol of selfless humanity, the very essence of compassion, duty, and benevolence. I imagine that, like me, many of you feel cheated that he was taken from us so soon. And yet we must learn to be grateful that he ever came along at all. Now, we're not here because Brother Stewart died. Rather, we're here because he lived a remarkable life. We're here to say thank you for the way he touched and brightened our lives. The truth is, all of us are better people because we knew him. And so while we grieve, as is appropriate, we do not sorrow as those who have no hope. But we look forward to the blessed day when once again we shall see him in the earth made new. Sister Stewart, Jackie and Karen, you've lost a great father. I have lost a great friend. Please know that you are in our thoughts and our prayers. We hope that the warm memories of Brother Stewart and the love of the many people whose lives he touched will be of comfort to you as you seek to balance the tension between grief and gratitude. When at last we bring the curtains down, by laying him to his final resting place, a great human story would have closed. Rest in peace, Brother Stewart. You left a lot of light and a lot of love. By the grace of God, we will ensure that the light continues to shine and the love continues to be shared. God bless the family. May his soul rest in peace. Thank you.
53 years ago, evangelist, Bible worker, and colporteur Mullings, accompanied by Sister Stevenson and Clark, came to work in this community and were attached to the Mansion Hill Church. Within 2 years, they literally took up the Stewart and the Sutton family and placed them at Mansion Hill. Brother Ewart Stewart and his brother-in-law Orlando Sutton displayed so much Christian characteristic and maturity and sense of purpose that within probably a year and little, they were elected to serve as deacons in the church at Mansion Hill. Both of them, being young men, married, were a little older than us. They represented that gap between my age group and the persons who were leaders in the church then. In 1973, I moved into the Long Bay community and began attending church here. They found out, I told them that I was here at the church. They decided that Sutton and Stewart family decided to join me down here, which meant immediately that the membership here more than doubled because they came with their older children. Yeah. Brother, both men continued their office, service in office as deacons here. Brother Stewart became extremely close to me because he was a person with a very inquiring mind who wanted to learn everything biblical. He would listen to a sermon and then he would say, I hear the speaker say so and so, but I can't wrap my mind around it yet, and would have discussion on it. And so he developed. He developed as a person, and he loved to study. If I describe him, I must say he was a most diligent, fervent, and purposeful deacon. He had great respect for the church buildings and the vessels and furnitures of the church. He would say to a young deacon, and we have persons here now who can testify to that, "No, handle it so, and a furniture like with a yard." The sanctity was important to him. He was a punctual and time-conscious deacon. And he was careful to extend the courtesies. I just observed another deacon who was trained by him, giving the services to persons coming in as the meetings prolonged. And I remember he was taught by Brother Ewart Stewart. He was a kind person, one of the kindest person I know in Long Bay. And that in itself, the kindness he extended to people, would result occasionally in people coming to church along with him. He gave fatherly advice to the young people. Like I told you before, it was a gap between us and the older, more mature person. So he gave fatherly advice. And because he was a sportsman of sort, play cricket and so forth, he gave him opportunity to relate to the younger persons. And he used every occasion that he had to mention something about God. In terms of being a deacon, he was also a builder. In fact, both of them, both Sutton and Stewart, that's were builders. And he has a building effort. A building mark, his hand mark, is in most of the churches in this district. And he served voluntarily. He gave willingly. And there were times when we would have said, "I want you to do this, do that, do that." And he would say, "Tell us so much." And he would say to me, "It going to cost you so much?" And then later on, he said, "Give me half of that." He was like that. I miss him as a personal friend. And the church, we are at a loss at his passing. But he held on to the blessed hope. And he brought up his children that way, and he talked of God in that way. We look forward to meeting him rising in the first resurrection. God bless you. Take courage, members of his family.
Hey, my name is Conroy Blake, one of the owners of Adrenaline and Green Block Development. So I want to share a real quick story about how I got introduced to Mr. Stewart. About 3 years or so ago, when we started developing the property, we wanted to put up a 12-foot fence. there was a tree that was hanging over from his side of the property. There was a branch that actually was hanging over about 8 feet, and didn't think much of it. I got one of the guys to get a machete to go up and chop it down, and we went back to work. About 2 or 3 hours later, Mr. Stewart came. And he was mad. I was like, "Whoa." Introduced himself as the new owner, as the owner of the property next door, and why he was upset. Apparently the guy didn't just follow the instructions we gave. He went above and beyond, and he almost cut the whole tree down. He cut off so much of the branch. And Mr. Stewart was really upset about it. You know, and we got talking, and he just expressed how much he loves farming. You know, his trees are like, you know, it's something really close and dear to him. And yeah, we started talking about things, and you know, that's kind of, strangely enough, that's how we met. He's been like really super cool as a neighbor. He would always invite us over and, you know, offer us whatever fruits or whatever things is in season. He was an avid farmer. He's always on his property working, and we would pass each other all the time. And he would always just say, hey, you know, if you need anything, let us know. You know, and vice versa. We basically looked out for each other. He would tell me, you know, he would kind of give me suggestion on how to go about moving around my property, and vice versa. You know, he would always just always extend himself. He knew we loved East Indian mangoes, and he would always, every time the season came in, he would always basically just say, hey, you know, you want mangoes, the tree has mango on it, come over and help yourself. And that's kind of just how our relationship was. He was a really, really nice guy. He always come by and say hello whenever he's working. If he sees me, we'll always end up in a 20 or 30 minute conversation just talking about the property and things that we've done and things that he's planning on doing and things that he has done. It's just really sad to see that he's gone. I know we're gonna miss looking over the fence and seeing him. And definitely as the season change and the different fruits come into play, eating an East Indian mango, especially off of his property, won't be the same, because we'll always remember him for that. He's always been good and generous to myself and my brothers. Anytime he saw us, he made sure that, you know, he'd call to us and go out of his way to offer us anything, anything that's in season on his property. Again, my condolences to the family, as neighbors. If there's anything we can do to help, please let us know.
I hear the sound of a mighty rushing wind, and it's closer now than it's ever been. I can almost hear the trumpets as Gabriel sounds the call at the midnight cry. We'll be gone. The bride of Christ will the midnight cry. When Jesus comes again, then those that remain will be quickly changed at the midnight cry, when Jesus comes again, at the midnight cry.
Good afternoon, everyone. We'd like to share with you memories of our dad, Ewart Alfonso Stewart. I was on my way home from a school trip. It was night and dark, raining cats and dogs. As I looked through the window of the bus, blurred from the rain, I prepared myself to dash through the dark lane to get home. I noticed in the distance the figure clad in rain gears and holding an umbrella. As the bus came to a halt, I realized the figure was my dad. I may have been about 8 years old at the time, but that image would be indelible throughout my entire life. This protector I just described was born on February 12, 1946 to Aston and Hazel Stewart in Boston, Portland, the district known for Jamaican jerk. Manny, as he was affectionately called, was the fifth of seven children. As a child, he was industrious and creative. He enjoyed swimming and playing cricket, using his creativity to make bats and wickets. After completing Boston Elementary School, he went on to learn carpentry with Mr. Willie Rudolph, who lived in Long Bay. He showed such great aptitude and quickly mastered the trade.
It was on one of his early building projects that he met the love of his life, Lena Sutton. Lena's brother Lloyd met three Seventh-day Adventists selling books, called porters as we call them. He introduced them to his father and siblings who lived together. The called porters visited regularly to study. He was reluctant because he did not like Seventh-day Adventists. I can only guess that his lack of interest might be because of his Boston jerk background. However, God had a plan for his life. And later, Lena and Ewart accepted Jesus as their personal savior. Both were united in holy matrimony and baptized in July 1970.
The marriage flourished and they were blessed with four beautiful children: Karen, Logie, or Cheryl, Courtney, Pauline, Dar, Claudia, Jackie, and two adopted children, Janice, my Seeley. Mansion Hill Seventh-day Adventist Church was their home church and they attended every week. It became difficult, however, to traverse that distance to church with the small children, so they transferred their membership to the nearby Long Bay Church. They soon became very active in the church. Edward was committed to the improvement of the building and was involved in the building projects that transformed the church. His passion for raising funds for the church was evident, and he would be the most competitive, especially at the rallies as his band would always be the winner. He was involved in the deaconry and was ordained deacon until his death.
In 1972, he received a farm worker's card and was employed on the program in the United States of America. His employer soon discovered his dedication and the leadership skills he owned. During his time on the farm work program, he was selected as a team leader and developed very close relationships with his colleagues as well as his boss. Being away from Jamaica, Manny did not neglect his first love, that of the relationship he had explored. Instead, it was strengthened when he bonded with the members of the Boston SDA Church in Massachusetts for the 6 months he was away from home each year. His service was requested year after year, always impressed with his work ethics and the high quality of his work. His employment in the farm work program continued until 2006, when he became concerned about his wife's safety since the children had left home and she was on her own.
Robert Greene once referred to William Shakespeare with the idiom, "Jack of all trades, but master of none." However, had he met Manny, he would have said the opposite. Jack of all trades and master of all. Because whatever his hands found to do, he would do it with all his might, asking God to direct him, and he would always be successful. In addition to his farm work employment, he maintained a farm in which he cultivated fruits, vegetables, and nearly all that grew in the soil. He was also a member of the Farmers Production and the Marketing Corporation Farmers Group in Long Bay. Fishing was a hobby that materialized into a livelihood, and he engaged in both diving and operating a boat. All these he mastered, but his passion was in designing and constructing beautiful homes. His workmanship spoke for itself, and his honesty would allow people, even those living abroad, to entrust him with all their building projects.
Family worship played an integral part within our family, and it was held mornings and evenings. Dad was
resourceful to his siblings, in-laws, nieces and nephews. They all looked to him for advice. He was respected by all.
He encouraged each of his children to achieve the best education, something he said he wished he had the opportunity to attain. He would often say, "You'd rather sit on a stool and give them the privilege to sit on a chair." So big he was on education that he would encourage and assist even those who are not his biological children to make education their priority. I benefited from his generosity when I was attending Portland High School. I lived in St. Thomas at the time, and it was extremely difficult to get transportation to and from school. Situation. He welcomed me in his home with open arms to stay during the weekdays to attend school. I was never treated any less than his daughters. And to me, he's like a dad.
I think Digicel will miss his patronage, as like them, his motto was, "Stay connected." You could rely on Dad to keep in touch with all the family members, whether it was his grandchildren, nieces, nephews, siblings, and even his in-laws. We would remark at how quickly he would finish his phone credit, but when he discovered WhatsApp, he was over the moon, as he was able to as he was able more than ever to connect with every Jackman, even those far we had reached. Most of all, he would implore us to maintain our spiritual relationship, reminding us that Jesus was coming soon.
Dad not only encouraged us to live worthy of God's praise, he demonstrated that in everything that he did. He has left a void no one can fill, and his legacy lives on in the lives he touched. He was a good father who made all the difference in his children's life. He was a pillar of strength, support, and joy. Although we knew he loved us, he did not allow us to get away with our misdeeds, using tough love to prove a point, and often not sparing the rod.
The man who epitomized who a true father should be, a protector who created a stable family environment where Christian principles were manifested, has left us. Dad went to sleep on September 19, 2021, after a brief illness. The joyous memories of his life will forever be cherished by his wife, Lena, children, Karen, Courtney, Pauline, Claudia, Janice, and Patrick. 18 grandchildren, Tevin, Damoy, Janelle, Deontay, Tyvon, Amani, China, Janae, Jazane, Trey, Shamika, Courtney, Kaden, Warren, Kawain, Andrew, Brianna, and Roman.
The sky shall unfold, prepare. Sleeping shall rise. those who remain shall be changed in a moment, and we shall behold him then face to face. We shall behold him. We shall.
Let the people of God say amen. Let the people of God praise the name of the Lord. We shall behold him, O Savior and Lord. Pray with me. Father, speak through me in Jesus' name. Amen. The text is Genesis. The chapter is 50. The verse is 24, sorry, the verses 24 and 25. And Joseph said to his brethren, I am dying, but God will surely visit you and bring you out of this land to the land which he swore to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob. Then Joseph took an oath from the children of Israel, saying, God will surely visit you, and you shall carry up my bones from here. Brothers and sisters, it was this Joseph who was sold into captivity in Egypt. Now Joseph, being a servant of God, at the end of the day, when the rubber meets the road, Joseph was about to take his last breath. And in Joseph's last statements, Joseph was here talking to his people, talking to his brethren, and Joseph was saying to them, I am dying, but God had made a promise, and I know that my God is a promise keeper, and he will surely visit you. I am dying, but I leave this with you. When I die, I want you to take my bones to where the Lord would have showed to my father, to where the Lord would have showed to Abraham. Can I talk to somebody today? The topic I've chosen to speak to you under today is a simple one. My mind is on Canaan. Brothers and sisters, Joseph's mind was on Canaan, because Canaan was the place where the Lord would have showed him. And Joseph said, peradventure you'll get comfortable down here. Peradventure
enter, you'll be complacent and you'll start acting like the Egyptians. Put my bone in a coffin, and when you see it, it should serve as a reminder that this is not your home. You're just passing through. I said, when you see the coffin, it should tell you that here you're not staying here for too long. You're going to Canaan. Can I take it home today that when you see a casket in a funeral service, it should remind you that it's appointed unto man once to die, but after the death comes the judgment. When you see a casket, you should not be comfortable, because we all have an appointment with death. It is one thing that we can run all we want, we can talk all we want, but when it comes down to the last moment, we all got to die. And then, brothers and sisters, I hear scripture say that yes, it's appointed unto man once to die, but after the death comes the judgment. Are you ready for the judgment? Are you wrapped up and tied up and tangled up in Jesus? Are you ready for the judgment? I'm talking to somebody. I'm done now. But are you ready for the judgment? Are you ready for the judgment? I don't know about you, but I'm longing for Canaan. God bless you.
Thank you so much, Pastor Hamilton, for that sobering word. We're now going to have the prayer for the bereaved family. We're going to invite the rest of the congregation to join us in standing as the bereaved family remains seated, as Pastor Thompson will be doing that prayer for us. So the rest of the congregation, you can stand with us as the family remains seated.
Okay, shall we bow our heads as we pray? Mighty Father, we thank you for journeying mercies. We thank you for all that which has taken place so far to comfort, strengthen the bereaved family. We thank you for the powerful, persuasive word that we prepare for Canaan. For we all will face death, life's common denominator. And may we live so that when death comes, we will be fully prepared. So comfort the bereaved family and give them the hope of heavenly inspiration. And may they recognize that the word of God truly said to them, family members, let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And since I go, I will come again and receive you unto myself, so that where I am, there ye may be also. May this be the inspiration in their heart, that they will see their loved one again. Their wonderful dad will see him again on the other side of Jordan. Thank you for hearing. Thank you for placing that inspiration and hope in their heart as we leave this place, in Jesus' name, amen.
Family, on behalf of the family of the late Ewart Stewart, we want to say thank you to everyone, of course, for the love, for the support, for the phone calls, for the prayers, for the visits, and for the encouragement. As we go, we want to pray for you journeying mercies back to your various places of abode. But remember to keep in touch with the family, especially going forward. They're going to need all of us now more than ever before. So on their behalf, I'd like to say thanks to all of you once again for the support. I'm going to invite you now to bow your heads as we say the benediction.
Thank you.
Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this very spot, where the body of your son now lies. We look forward to that great getting up morning when Jesus himself shall call, and when the dead in Christ shall hear his voice. We look forward to Brother Stewart reuniting with his family. What a hallelujah morning it's going to be. And so I ask you now to touch each member of the family. Give them the strength and the resolve to carry on and to hold on to Jesus. And I pray, Lord, that you will hasten that glad day of your coming. And then we will die. And God forevermore.